All right, well, they have the color thing, but not the jump list. So it's an interesting way you can extend your website onto the desktop. Oh, there we go. It populated. So we can see that this is run by Andrew Duthie. There's his blog. That's the Twitter for Community Megaphone, the shortcut to add an event, and link to the podcast. So you can really, enhance the experience beyond just a typical kind of browser type experience. This only works with Windows 7 and IE9 and up. But there have been studies where the traffic increases to the site because it's the branding is there. You can actually drag this to desktop too. No, not going to work. So something to keep in mind. So that's it for my slides. So if there's something in particular you want me to drive into, we certainly can do that. I know it's a bit early. So any questions at this point? You have a question?
Were there any kind of announcements around Azure, any of the Azure App Fabric type things that you happen to remember?
There was more updates regarding tooling around Azure, but nothing in particular. I suspect there was an announcement regarding WCF tooling being better integration with Azure, but the exact specifics escape me.
The other question I have is there any kind of expansion of the Nokia linking in with Windows Phone 7 and the announcements?
It's funny you mention that. So the question was there any more mention of Nokia and the Windows Phone 7 announcement? During the keynote, one of the speakers actually made mention that there's a lot of Symbian developers in the audience wanting to learn Silverlight. So, very interesting. I suppose that if you base your career on Symbian and you heard the news, it was probably a bit of a shock to hear that. So, that was really the only thing that came up in regards to that specific topic.
On the Mango, you think you just said it was out towards the end of this year?
Yeah, so the question was regarding Mango. The word I kept hearing was fall, and that's when Microsoft is going to push it to the carriers. When the carriers decide to get around to it is, well, that's anyone's guess. Who knows? Maybe there'll be, like, instead of like a sports book in Vegas, there'll be a carrier book in Vegas. I don't know with the odds of who's going to get it first. Being a Sprint customer, I have to say I've been very spoiled because I've always had Nodo. I thought that was because of they were really loved us so much they didn't want us to experience the upgrade pain. But apparently, one of the things Nodo does is enable CDMA support. So whenever Verizon launches theirs, it's going to have Nodo. And I have no information on when that's going to happen.
Said that the browser in the Mango was going to be
IE10. That was really the other thing too, is right now the browser in the phone is not IE9. In Mango, one of the updates that we're going to get is that the browser will be IE9, and that means that all the HTML5 tricks and stuff you can do on a desktop will also work, I guess, in varying degrees on the phone. I'm sure there's going to be some catches, because I mean, realistically, I have 8 processors on this. I don't have 8 on this, and I probably don't have a GPU. The lag time is about 10 years, so this is about as powerful as my desktop was 10 years ago. So it'll be interesting. Yes?
Just so you know, there were actually a couple Azure announcements.
There were?
Yeah, so App Fabric caching is now commercially available, so it's out of
The content management, CDN stuff, yes.
The access control service V2 is now released to the web for production use. And then there was something else. The preview of being able to do smooth streaming via the Azure Content Delivery Network off of WebOS.
Oh, that's right. There's just so much flinging at you during the keynotes that you can't catch everything.
Yeah.
If you haven't seen them already, I highly recommend watching them. And the nice thing about watching them here as opposed to being there live is you can rewind and like, oh, I want to see that again. Or so, yeah, that's any
you
questions?
Them, I think I'm mostly on another website. It's live.
Which one?
All those webcasts for Mix.
Oh, yes. So if you go to this site in here, you'll see the... Mix sessions. It's actually now hosted on Channel 9. It's not on.
If you go to live.vinifmix.com.
Nah, it's been moved to Channel 9. There's also on Scott Hanselman's blog a list of all the RSS feeds so you can put it into your favorite podcast software. So you can just fetch all the stuff at once. I wrote an app on the plane right back, which is kind of sad. To scrape the website, and because they didn't have those feeds available yet, so it went out, it scraped the these pages basically, and fetched all the content, and it still works. It's just it's a little hokey. So your podcaster software is probably going to be a little bit more elegant as far as handling multiple streams and being asynchronous. And I just found out that the bootcamp content, which originally was not going to be posted publicly, some of the slides and some of the sessions from that, is already been posted.
I think there was mention made of the jQuery for Rhea services. Any more details on that?
And then we go to Jeff Handley's blog. He talks about it a lot too. You can actually download it's something you can download and play with now.
Any other questions? Yes.
Any performance comparison between HTML5 and Cephalon for the same kind of job or something?
So the question was, any performance comparison between Silverlight 5 and HTML5? I've not seen anything like that yet. My guess is Silverlight would have a slight advantage, but Silverlight is still in beta, so there's a lot of performance optimizations that tend to happen towards the end. You thought it would be the opposite?
Yeah.
Why?
I mean, it's built in the browser itself, HTML5. It's
It is built in the browser, but that's a good question. It really could go either way because I know a lot of the same folks that did the optimization for Silverlight on the GPU ended up going to the Internet Explorer team and doing the same thing there. I don't know. It's a good question because you assume the browser's written in native code, and maybe that would give it a slight edge. But you still have another layer of abstraction as far as interpreting HTML, and it does have to be loaded at runtime, whereas the ZAP is pre-compiled into, I don't know. As far as I know, no comparison like that exists yet. I would imagine that somebody somewhere will probably do something like that. But until it's not going to be a fair fight until Silverlight is more closer to RTM.
Yeah, I think it'll be interesting to see that. So
yeah.
It could be either way. Then, like I said, it really depends. Silverlight is a sort of client. Code, right? So it's a browser plugin, but once you download it, it's running within on your desktop. Similarly, I think if the JavaScript, I think it's also running on your client. So I think it depends on the actual activity, function of that particular screen. If it's just within the browser versus you need to make calls to the middle tier or to the back end. So it'll be interesting to see. I haven't seen that, so. Good question.
And then, the other thing to bring out is that there's performance and then there's performance. I mean, do you mean like hitting the network and then getting resources back? Or do you mean like actual, turning graphics on the screen? Or?
Well, I mean, both ways, actually.
Both?
Yeah.
Networking, I mean, the latency of the network is going to be your big performance bottleneck for anything.
Sure, yeah, I'm done, so.
Any questions for Frank?
We still have a few minutes, but this is a good time to complete your eval form. Does anybody care to see some source code of a Windows Phone 7 application? That's something you can use.
Just feel free to contact me through my email or website. FrankSchwoll.com is the website, and email is franklma@microsoft.com.